our second plenary speaker, and then there will be a brief panel on, a comparative panel on Latin America, then there will be a coffee break when people can mill around again, and then there will be a second panel focused on Brazil. So much is yet to come. So it's important for us to get going, and I appreciate your, we all appreciate your collaboration. So I am going to now turn the mic over to my friend and colleague and co-conspirator in this project, Charlie Hale, who will introduce our second plenary speaker, Marisol de la Cadena.
Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. What a terrific session this morning, and I think I'm sure what our speaker now, Marisol de la Cadena, will say will build on and deepen all the issues that were raised in the morning. It's a great pleasure to have the opportunity to introduce Marisol. She's professor of anthropology at UC Davis. She's author of a terrific book called Indigenous Mestizos, which challenges a whole series of orthodoxies around race, culture, identity, both in Peru and also in the way non-Peruvian scholars have looked at Peru. And it's widely read and admired in both in Latin American studies and in theoretical, those interested in theoretical issues that it raises. She's been an active participant, perhaps a founding member, of the World Anthropologies Network, which is an organization, a network about deparochializing hegemonic anthropologies and developing a kind of a much wider and more critical dialogue around key notions that concern us here. And she's also involved currently in collective efforts to think critically about the ontological precepts of modernist politics and to work with others to help us collectively imagine radical alternative politics, political practices, and horizons. I'm a great admirer of Marisol's work. It's never the point to agree. It's always the point to be in dialogue and to accept her invitation to a dialogue that none of us can refuse if we feel seriously and deeply the commitment to address the monumental social problems that we face and the need, as was said this morning in the first keynote, to develop political strategies to address, analyze, and address those problems, and to imagine radical alternatives. So thank you, Marisol, for being with us, and we look forward to your talk, Protesting from the Uncommons.
Thanks, everybody. It's a real pleasure, joy, and fun to be here. Thanks, Sonia, for organizing these and for inviting me. Thanks, Barbara. Thanks, Arturo, for being part of the group and for inspiring me also. And thanks for that introduction, Charlie. I also accept your invitation to think with you. And I always have you in mind when I'm about to write something that I'm not sure about, and I think, what would Charlie think of this? And so you're a great inspiration, really. This talk has had many titles, and Protesting from the Uncommons is the one that I settled with. It comes from I am an anthropologist, and I think ethnographically. So although there's a lot of theoretical background and foreground to what I'm going to say, I want to ground it and it is grounded, not that I want to ground it, but it is grounded in my conversations with Mariano and Nazario Turpo, two indigenous Quechua-speaking intellectuals and ritual specialists with whom I worked during many, many years in a remote village in the highest mountains of Cusco. And I felt that it was cheating if I only wrote the first line, the second line, thinking with Mariano and Nazario Turpo. So I thought that the smaller letters had to be there because I've put them in conversation with Rancière and Stengers, and I've made Mariano and Nazario tweak Rancière and Stengers to say, to allow me to say what I think Mariano and Nazario are saying. So it's Mariano and Nazario tweaking Stengers and Rancière to the point that perhaps people are going to say, no, that's not what Rancière says or what Stengers says. In fact, she claims that it's not what she says, and I say, I don't care. It's what Mariano allows me to say using you. So it's a totally utilitarian use of their concepts. And it is ethnographic, and in the way that I define ethnography, which is that seamless combination between, or composition, between what we call the empirical and the theoretical, to the point that once you're writing it, you cannot pull either part apart, where you cannot pull apart the empirical or the theoretical. Ethnography is the coming, the beautifully coming together of both. I like ethnography. So, having said that, I want to introduce you to Nazario, my friend, and Mariano, his father. I met them because Nazario, because Mariano, they are both politicians and ritual specialists. But that's our rendition, our translation of what they do, because in what they do, politics and ritual are one. So I wouldn't have a word, a one word to describe what they do. I learned from them as I followed their protests. Mariano was key in organizing the event that eventually provoked the agrarian reform in Peru in 1968. So he was an activist since the 1940. This is a picture taken by the person who introduced me to him, Tomás Müller, when Mariano was much younger than when I met him. I met him in 2001 and he was 90 years old. So this is 16 years earlier and he was much younger than when I met him. Their definition of politics, of power actually, and of politics, combines humans and other than human beings. Most important of them being Ausangati, this massive mountain that was the witness to our conversations throughout almost 10 years. What I'll tell you here started with my participation in the defense of this mountain. And now I'm going to start reading, and I'm going to read on and off and stop to explain some slides, but hopefully I won't exceed the time. So what I will tell you here started with my participation in the defense of Ausangati. It was August 2006. And I had just arrived in Cusco for a 2 or 3 month stay. I received a phone call from Nazario, who told me he couldn't come to the house where I was staying. Instead, could I go to the Plaza de Armas of Cusco, the main square? There was a demonstration there. The people gathering on that day in the main square of Cusco had come from the region where Nazario's village is located, because a mining corporation was prospecting Ausangati, an earth being and also a mountain, and therefore a potential reservoir of minerals, possibly gold. So Ausangate was threatened. Earth beings are also known as Wakas, entities for which colonial extirpators of idolatries like Cristóbal de Albornoz in 1584 demanded destruction. It is impossible, he said, to take from them, these Indians, this superstition, because the destruction of these Wakas would require more force than that of all the people in Peru in order to move these stones and hills. So Cristóbal de Albornoz was an extirpator of idolatries, idols, like little icons like this. And in Peru, extirpators of idolatries found themselves with idols that were actually this. So it's impossible to remove from them their idolatries because we cannot destroy their idols. How are we going to destroy them? Earth beings is my translation from the word with which I met them, with which I met earth beings. And that word is Tiracuna, plural for the Spanish. It's a combined Quechua and Spanish word that is a plural for tierras, earths. Cuna is the pluralizing form. So tira is tierra, and cuna the plural of tierras. And I'm going to use this moment to introduce another word that I'm going to be saying frequently, and that's runa cuna, the word that refers for people in the plural. Okay, so the Albornoz translated Wakas as stones and hills and took their enormity as the cause of the difficulty to eradicate what he considered superstitions. Removing them appeared impossible, for Wakas were earths. 500 years later, mining corporations also translate earth beings as mountains and as a source of minerals and therefore wealth. Unlike their colonial counterparts, they have the power to remove mountains, redirect rivers, or replace lakes with efficient reservoirs for water. So this is a lake in 1992, the superior part of the slang, and this is the lake in 2006. The power of mining corporations to undo what could have been an earth being. Extremely productive in economic terms, this technology is also extremely polluting, and it also represents the ultimate threat to earth beings. With it, they face nothing less than destruction. In 2006, mining ventures were knocking on the door of my friend's village. They were promising development, but the terms of this development threatened earth beings with destruction. However, and this was key, the destruction of Ausangate would be a complex phenomenon. For rather than exclusively human, the earth being would also participate in the event, and in response to the attempts at open pit mining, it would destroy the mining process and all of those nearby, including Runa Cuna. And again, I remind you, Runa Cuna is the word that we would translate as Indians. People reject it and they call themselves Runa Cuna, and that's why I use it. A discussion among people who would be affected resulted in a coalition of people decided to prevent this kind of mining from happening. And it's only this kind of mining, because mining in the Andes has been a colonial press since colonial times. There has been mining in the Andes. The difference is the technology now. The technology now destroys. If you have ever seen the Cerro Rico de Potosí, the gold mine of Potosí is full of tunnels inside, right? So it's not mining per se that this demonstration was against. It was against the destruction of the being. The demonstration in the Plaza de Armas was a public act that accompanied a delegation visit, a delegation visit to El Presidente de la Región, the president of the region. Ideally, they would convince him and the rest of authorities that mountain was not only a mountain, and thus summarily translatable via its destruction into minerals. Ausangate was also an earth being. But of course, these terms were not easy for the authorities to accept. So the decision of the activists was to subordinate the defense of the earth being to the defense of the environment. This the state could recognize, perhaps even admit as rightful. The villagers achieved their end. As of today, there's no mine in Ausangate. The mountain won, the mining attempt lost. But to earn this victory, the earth being was made invisible. Its political presence recalled by the alliance that also defended it. So in addition to political ecology and political economy, these contests that I'm describing also transpired in the field of political ecology, ontology. Yet political ontology was a subdued partner in the arena of contention. That the mountain was also an earth being was made invisible as the question unfolded publicly. The reason? In the field of modern politics, tiracuna are cultural beliefs. And as such, weak matters of political concern when confronted to the facts offered by science, economy, or nature. Thus, to save Ausangate from being swallowed by the mining corporation, activists themselves recalled it from the negotiation. They recalled Ausangate as earth being. Their radical difference exceeded modern politics, which could not tolerate Ausangate as being other than a mountain. Now, I want to pause here for a little bit because I've said radical difference. I've mentioned that word. And I want to make clear the way I think of radical difference. And what I want to say is that radical difference is not something that indigenous peoples have. It's not to be understood as a quality of isolated indigeneity, for there's nothing like isolated indigeneity. Indigeneity exists within and with Latin American nation-state institutions. Rather than something that indigenous peoples have, radical difference is a relational condition emerging when or if the parties, all of them or some of them, involved in the enactment of a reality are equivocal in the sense of Viveiros de Castro notion of equivocation, are equivocal about what is being enacted. Not unusually in the Andes, radical difference emerges as a relationship of excess between indigeneity and the state. Now, what is excess? I conceptualize excess as that which is beyond the limit, or, and this is Guha, the first thing outside which there is nothing to be found, and the first thing inside which everything is to be found. Yet this nothing is in relation to what sees itself as everything. It is something, a real that is not a thing, not nothing, that's not a thing accessible through knowledge as usual. It exceeds knowledge as usual. The limit is ontological, and establishing it, a political epistemic practice with the power to cancel the reality of all that appears outside it. And here's an example. I couldn't control myself, and I had to put that little picture that I found. This is ex-president of Peru, Alan Garcia, declaring that he's the only Apu. Now, Apu is the other word that's used for earth being, which also means chief, which means that earth beings are chiefs. And he declares, yo soy el Apu, I'm the Apu. And the declaration went viral. Rafael, you might remember it. He said, we need to defeat those absurd and pantheistic. I'm not going to read it. You can read it. It just reminded me of Cristóbal de Albornoz. right? It's he's an heir to Cristóbal y Albornoz. The difference between both of them is that one, he can grant corporations the power to destroy the idols, superstitions, and that the antidote to superstition is not baptism, but modern education. So, but as it turned out, Ausangate was not the only earth being to enter the political discussion at a relatively same time. The accelerated mining and oil concessions in previously uncharted territory provoked protests that made several other beings public. And in neither of these cases were indigenous terms accepted as possible, thus revealing the limits of recognition as the political relationship that the modern state, liberal or socialist, extends to what it considers its others. Recognition is an offer for inclusion that, not surprisingly, can only transpire in terms of state cognition, its recognition. Among other things, those terms of cognition partition the sensible, and here is what I'm starting to use, Francine, partition the sensible into a single nature and differentiated humans. Only humans can be political interlocutors of the state, and as such, as political interlocutors of the state, they cannot alter the agreement that other than humans are not, that other than humans do not exist. They are not. That's the agreement that cannot be altered. Thus, we can understand Garcia's stanza. Earth beings cannot be, period. Give me a break. They are a non-event, and this is reminding also Trujillo's terms, the Haitian Revolution as a non-event. They are a non-event, and debating about their presence in modern politics is aporetic. Left and right. Left and right, mountains are nature, and earth beings are ahistorical entities. Cultural beliefs to be pondered according to the rational distance from the West, the world that gave history to the rest. Modern politics is within a possible that can be recognized as historical. Here I want to break a moment to bring Sonia, Arturo's, and Evelina's, Daniño's work into the conversation. That culture of politics, politics of culture, that has always been in the back of my mind, except that I'm replacing the word culture for the word ontology. Ontology of politics, politics of ontology. And what I'm going to be saying next is that politics has an ontology. It's not ontology-less. That ontology occupies a blind spot that from where politics says what is and is not political. So modern politics is within a possible that can be recognized as historical. This means that the enactment of what cannot be historical, that of what cannot be historically verified, is not a subject or object of politics because the reality is doubtful, to say the least. And this resonates with what Michal and Barbara were talking this morning. What cannot be recognized as happening is not. It's a failure. It doesn't exist. It's not. This ontological bottom line is not to be probed. It is the undisputed spot from where reality as we know it is enacted. Hence, opening up that spot offers the possibility of questioning the self-evidence on which the ontological makeup of modern politics rests. Politics needed not be historical, but it is, and undisputably so. I suggest that this requirement to be historical composes the coloniality of modern politics and the way it partitions the sensible. The latter is, let's see, not yet. The latter is a concept Rancière uses to refer to the distribution of the visible into activities that are seen and others that are not, and the division of the sayable into forms of speech that are recognized as discourse and others are discarded as noise. That's the partition of the sensible. There are things that can be seen, there are things that can be heard. Period. Ontologically underpinned by coloniality, entities, relations, or circumstances have to be historical to be politically heard or seen. Accordingly, the disagreement that confronts such condition disarrays the current practices of politics, and that disagreement is also ontological. Introducing the notion of ontological to disagreement, I'm tweaking Rancière's notion of disagreement. As he conceptualizes it, the disagreement that is politics emerges from, quote, a wrong count of the parts of the whole. Instead, I propose that politics emerges when that which considers itself the whole denies existence to that which exceeds it, or, to use Rancière's words, makes it count as not counting, because, in my words, it exceeds the principle that partitions the sensible into historical existence and ahistorical non-existence. This miscount itself is an ontological practice, and so is the politics that emerges from a disagreement with it. After this proviso, Rancière and I may agree. Politics, he says, exists, and this is a quote, through the fact of the magnitude that escapes ordinary measurement. It is the introduction of the incommensurable at the heart of the distribution of speaking bodies. That's the end of the quote. Earth beings and the people that are with them, the Runakuna, introduce such an incommensurable. They are the uncommons, disrupting the heart of the division between nature and culture, which parts the historical from the ahistorical and grants power to history to certify the real. Tirakuna with Runakuna enact an impossible challenge to the historical ontology of the sensible. How can the ahistorical, that which has no part within what considers itself the whole, repartition the sensible? Given this impossibility, in the specific case I witness, to protect Ausangate from destruction, the challenge that the earth being posed was recalled by those who proposed it, who remade their claim, joining that which could be recognized, and as historical at that, the environment. The negotiation was to take place within the partition of the sensible to protect what exceeded it. The becoming public of earth being, so something was at stake. It was not only an ideological contest of power. It was life that was at stake, and that's why I recall the earth being, to protect the earth being. I don't have an ideological contest to win. The becoming public of earth beings disagrees with the prevalent partition of the sensible. It presents modern politics with that which is impossible under its conditions and implies an alteration of those conditions. This provokes a scandal that's followed by its trivialization, that it's followed by the trivialization of the profound disruption in the partition of the sensible that the mere public presence of those entities enacts. So Alan Garcia's is one of those trivializations of the scandal, right? Nothing happened here, these are superstitions, let's educate all of them, let's forget about these. The problem is uneducated people. The problem is not an ontological conflict. And this is also another. Do you remember Pablo Stefanoni's Hacia Donde Nos Lleva el Pachamamismo? Where does Pachamama mismo take us. This is the image that illustrated the article, which I cannot remember what it was. But it was a webpage, and here it is. And this is Goya's painting. And I've translated it. It says, El sueño de la razón produce monstruos. And I've freely translated it. You can have your own interpretation. I freely translated it as, a sleeping reason produces monsters. Or those who have no reason, those who have lost reason, Runakuna presenting mountains as earth beings, present monsters. Mountains are mountains. Immanent moments like the Ausangate and like the dispute of Ausangate against the prospective mind, ontological disagreement emerges from practices, and I'm going to go slow on these, emerges from practices that make worlds diverge even as they continue to make themselves connected to one another. So I'm not talking about separate worlds here. I'm talking about the connection that makes them together and diverge. They are together and they diverge. Composed with stuff barely recognizable beyond the local, these moments, like the defense of Ausangate, travel with difficulty and are hardly cosmopolitan. Who would recognize, how does Ausangate travel as a human being? Only if I translate it through Stengers, through Rancière, through Latour. Earth beings do not travel they are not cosmopolitan theory. I have to make them travel in cosmopolitan theory. But they compose cosmopolitical moments with the capacity to irritate the universal and provincialized nature and culture. Now, I want to stop here to look at these slides for a second. This is Cosmopolitics, Anna Stengers, and Mariano Nazario, Earth Beings. So this is not only Isabel Stengers. For Stengers, Cosmopolitics presents, she says that she composed that notion with two words, cosmos, which is the unknown that impinges on what she calls, and what I have called politics as usual, and which is impinges on that which takes place within what Latour has called the modern constitution, the constitution that constituted the world as we know it, or what Rancière would call the partition of the sensible. And I say that cosmopolitical moments provincialize nature and culture. They suggest that nature and culture is specific to the world inaugurated by the modern constitution, shaped by the partition of the sensible, or that shaped the partition of the sensible. And on provincializing nature and culture, on making it specific to a world, open up a cosmos, an unknown. Because I don't know what an earth being is, and we can talk about that if the question comes up. These cosmopolitical moments may propose an altered politics capable of alliances and adversarialisms with that which modern politics, left and right, has evicted from its field. And this capacity, unlike modern politics, would not require translating difference into sameness, thus complicating the agreement that modern politics imposes on those it admits. Modern politics says, you're like me or you're not a subject or an object of politics. Stengers' cosmopolitical proposal opens up with the following phrase. She says, how can we present a proposal intended not to say what is or what ought to be, but to provoke thought, a proposal that requires no other verification than the way in which it is able to slow down reasoning and create an opportunity to arouse a slightly different awareness of the problems and situations mobilizing us. how do we write a proposal that is not intent, that doesn't want to say what is or what ought to be? That immediately takes us away from estatutos de social movements, who state what they are, or of political parties, which state what they are and where they want to go. So this is really a proposal to open up thought, slow down thought, to open it up to that which we don't know. Earth being, in politics, in my case, many other things. Thinking with Stenger's proposal and also tweaking it through my conversations with Mariano Nazario, my own proposal is by diverging from the established partition of the sensible, practices with earth beings propose a cosmopolitics, relations among worlds as a practice of politics without the requirement of ontological sameness. That is a decolonial practice of politics. Stenger's proposal is not Runacunas' proposal, of course. Yet, both are different from projects that know what they are and what they want to be and where they're going. And therefore, more frequent than not, they command, they tell us what to do and how to be. Instead, Stenger's cosmopolitical proposal wants to speak in the presence of, those are the words, her words, in the presence of those that may ignore commanding words. Those words that order to follow the partition of the sensible as a condition to have a political voice. And according to her, ignoring the command would mean a preference not to have a political voice. And that's something open, not to have a political voice. But ignoring the command, I say, may also mean following the command to have a political voice. And at the same time, continue to remain outside the partition of the sensible. So following the command and not, that's what I witness all the time living with my friends. So not following the command, not following the command, bringing earth beings into politics, and following the command, participating in municipal elections. Not following the command, following the command. In undoing both things, you're exactly not following the command, which is to be the same. Runacuna practices complexly ignore the command for a nature culture divine, and they also followed it without becoming it. They were able to present a difference that escaped the command and slowed down the arena of what was foundational to the principle that partitions the sensible into humans and things, including other than humans in their interactions with modern institutions, the state, national, NGOs, international foundations. Runacuna practices enacted intriguing ontopistemic ruptures with the world of those institutions and revealed divergence among worlds. Runacuna practices refuse to convert to the hegemonic divide while nevertheless participating in it. So how can you say they are non-modern? They participate, yes, but they are also amodern. They also do things that modernity cannot stand. Now, the notion of politics, as I am using it here, and that emerged from conversation with Mariano and Nazario, refers to negotiations with humans and other than human beings. It is not a universal anthropological category, which probably the notion of modern politics never was. Modern politics was and continues to be a historical event in a complex arena where the proposal to build one world via cultural assimilation reached an agreement that was not only an agreement. Disagreement, or the practices of the part that has no part, continued to be with the agreement and exceeded it. Paradoxically, it is through the coloniality of politics, its assimilationist resolve to force what exceeds it to fit the partition of the sensible or self or else cease being, that those same excesses inevitably contaminate modern politics, or better, become a divergent part of it. Rejecting them, like Alan Garcia did, does not cancel the contamination, nor does it protect those that perform the rejection from being contaminated, from not participating in the divergence. The other is always part of them as much the other way around. This is a partial connection that neither modern politics nor indigeneity escape. Rather, they are entangled in each other and exceed each other in mutual radical difference, while at the same time participating in similarity, one that complexly is not only similarity. Okay, now, again, another bracket, parentheses. I've used the word divergence a lot, and I'm using it to think about a commons without undoing the uncommons. Divergence is another concept that I borrow from Isabel Stengers, and I've used it to say that ontological disagreement may emerge from practices that make worlds diverge, even as they continue to make themselves connected to one another. So divergence is a connection that's also a tension that separates. So divergence is the coming together of heterogeneous practices that will remain such and also become self-different, other to what they were. For example, a mountain and an earth being overlapping and diverging or exceeding each other. And so do the world of Runakuna and the world of the state. Both have, and this is a very nice phrase that I've borrowed from Isabel Stengers, a very powerful phrase. They have an interest in common that is not the same interest. So how to build a commons with the uncommons? This is, to me, a tool to think about that, divergence. To think about interests in common that are not the same interest. Ausangate, mountain, earth being, an interest in common, not the same interest. Why is the notion of divergence useful? Because it allows me to think connections among heterogeneities that remain heterogeneous. And thus it enables analysis that complicate the separation between the modern and the non-modern, and at the same time are able to highlight radical difference. The radical difference that converge in a complex knot of disagreement, untying disagreement, rather than agreement, may force the public acknowledgement of ontological politics. So if you have divergence in mind, and you're untying disagreement, you're not going to reach agreement, which to me is the end of politics, but you're going to allow for the possibility of ontological disagreement as politics. Such a knot has recently become public in Bolivia, Ecuador, and Peru. Unexpectedly, in the history of Andean nation states, the new constitution of Ecuador inscribed the rights of nature and Pachamama. I'm going to go fast because you'll know this. And in 2012, following the example, Bolivia decreed the law of Mother Earth. While perhaps unintended, both documents challenged the modern constitution and the partition of the sensible effective. And they also manifest the work of politics as ontological disagreement. Specifically loud in Bolivia, pundits and analysts complain about the incoherence between the government's declared adherence to the defense of Mother Earth or Pachamama and its choice of development policies based on mega extractive politics, as this declaration by Vice President Garcia Linera. Yet the conundrum that these laws and their implementation articulate goes beyond government incoherence. Yes, the government is incoherent, but that's not the main thing that's going on there. That may be a political problem when thinking politics as usual, but that's not the main conflict that I'm interested in. This conundrum is made with questions about what the practices and the entities they engage with, either in confrontation or adherence, are. What the practices or the entities are, and the way they might inconvenience the established sensible, threatening with tearing its fabric, or at least poking it. Not surprisingly, the discussion cannot reach an agreement. Radical differences between nature and Pachamama cannot be undone, and there being more than one and less than many, that's Merrin's return, complicates the discussion. Inflecting Rancière's terms ethnographically, the quarrel that takes place in Bolivia and Ecuador expresses an ontological disagreement. It is being publicly manifested in these countries. This disagreement cannot be overcome because the principle that partitions the sensible into nature and culture and divides those who count from those who do not is not common to all parts. This disagreement manifests the impossibility of a community. It's an ontological dispute made public that continues to be dismissed. And that is part of the ontological politics itself. Persistently present, even those politicians and pundits that impatiently denounce the scandal that the presence of other than humans in politics represents find themselves caught in the ontological dispute, albeit unevenly has become a constituted element of the Andean political atmosphere. These quotes by Garcia and Linera and Correa and the previous one by Alan Garcia are located at this precise site. They dismiss the disagreement as they contend that refusing extractivism to protect Autzangate, for example, is an inferior right compared to the right of the state to decide what the common good is. Okay, so, but what if, I'm going to finish here, but what if nature, the material basis of the common good, is not only such? And this is, I borrowed this quote from your paper. This is Sabino Walinga in 2012. Sarayaku is a living land. And then as I was writing this paper, this was something that I saw in Alai Latina. This is just the most recent struggle that's happening in Chile. And both are saying these are not only territories, these are living entities. But then my point is that you don't need earth beings. So earth beings provincialize nature. They show that nature is not a universal entity. They show that it belongs to a specific ontological genealogy. But you don't need, and this is something that I want to make very clear and I can end here, but you do not need earth beings to provincialize nature. What do I mean by provincial nature? I mean, to enact provincial nature, the political enactment of provincial nature. It's an enactment that overtly refuses universal nature. And how it does it is by rejecting translation into its delocalization. And how it does that is by opposing its representation through units, the units that science or economics and those documents that evaluate the impact evaluation documents utilize. So it opposes its representation to units. It presents itself as ecologically composed by the entanglement of beings, and it forcefully enacts itself as local. This is a picture of, and I'll end with this, the picture of Guardianes de las Lagunas, a struggle that's been going on for how many years, Rafael, I cannot remember. And they are not defending earth beings there. What they are doing is enacting provincial nature. Nature is local. What is us, plants, animals, rocks, against the pretension of the corporation of exchanging water for water? So you have water in that lagoon, I'm going to give you a restaurant water. Water is water. And what they are saying is, water is us. It's plants, animals, rocks, what you have in these territories that we are also. This is not an earth being. So you do not need earth being to analyze, to think about confrontations that are ontological confrontations, that are about ontological disagreement. Okay.
Thank you. Can everybody hear me back there? Good afternoon. My name is Angelica Bernal. I'm a member here with the Political Science Department at UMass Amherst, and it's an incredible honor and pleasure to be able to respond to Professor de la Cadena's amazing work, which has been in like a Copernican revolution to my own, helping me to really rethink some of my work that I'm doing on my current project about extractivism, so really amazing. I just wanted to begin with a recent case from my own work, and I'll try to keep this in, I will keep it in 7 minutes. I work in Ecuador, and recently, as some of you that are more familiar with this situation and protests in Latin America know, protests against extractivism has been huge. And in Ecuador in particular, in late August of 2013, you had these mass protests igniting over President Correa's decision to abandon what was called the Yasuni ITT initiative, which is an initiative that was to protect one of the most biologically diverse and delicate regions in the Amazon, and also home to at least 5 indigenous populations. It's also home to the country's richest oil fields. The idea this was an idea originally by indigenous groups and ecological groups, but Correa co-opted it, as he does many ideas, and presented it as we're going to set up a fund, a fund in the UN Development Program, where basically we're going to ask the world to contribute about $3.6 billion, and if the world fails, then we'll open it up. By August 15th, 2013, he said, well, the world has failed us. We've only raised $13.1 million, and now we're going to open up this region. Now, in reaction to this move, something incredible happened. For a president that has enjoyed incredible popularity and a hegemonic power, which is that you had the eruption of violent protest in late August and September, bringing thousands of indigenous and non-indigenous protesters to the streets of Quito. Now, in protesting Correa and government's actions against aggressive extractivism, indigenous and environmental activists did something unprecedented in such a large scale, which is they took to the streets, doing something unique, making the presence of earth beings, what Professor de la Cadena has talked to us about. They invoked Yasuni and Pachamama, and with them, nature as an entity with its own political agency, not only as a subject, but agent of constitutional rights. That is, in so doing, they made visible the presence of Tiracuna, earth beings, not as a site of protest we are advocating for nature, but rather as protest actors themselves. In their protest repertoires, as the ubiquitous protest sign said, Yasuni vive, Yasuni's alive. So in a time of protest where the unrepresentable multitudes have continually burst forth to disrupt state power, Professor de la Cadena's address and her work provides another crucial disruption. Mainly, it reframes protest staged by indigenous movements throughout the Andes as bringing forth another unrepresentable earth beings, whose being made public brings to light another dimension of protest, protest as a politics of ontological disagreement. De la Cadena's politics as ontological disagreement invites us all to reformulate the long-standing social justice dilemma of how to best change the world. According to John Holloway's, the revolutionary challenge for the 21st century is that of changing the world by not taking power, that is, not taking control of state structures. But De la Cadena's insight suggests, in my view, another approach, one that parcels part of that question, the meaning of the so-called quote-unquote world that we are trying to change and on what terms. This is not simply to say there are many worlds in one world, but actually a more pointed and complex critique, that the one world upon which the state structures and various political actors alike is constructed is upon a political epistemic practices that draw a line between what counts as the appropriate domain of politics versus that of science, which belongs to man and what that belongs to nature, which belongs to nature that which and what belongs to culture, which to the sensible and that which is beyond the outside. So this is something distinct from just about different temporalities. It's a different set of binaries that we're bringing in here. The politics of ontological disagreement revealed by Earth being practices and protests radicalizes, I think, our understanding of these protests and the generative potential of these politics. The battlefield is not simply between two human actors. In my case that I talked to you about, it's not the Ecuador state and its president versus indigenous groups and environmental actors seeking to resist extractivism, but one acting against nature and the other for it. It's not just one acting against nature and the other for it. Instead, we're coming to view the battlefield as different. We're unbeknownst to Correa and actors. Actors are increasingly reshaping the very field in which they're playing politics. And I see that in such cases like the Ecuador case, it's particularly effective. As of 2 weeks ago, we began to see more violent protests against Correa, showing again that these ontological disagreements are yielding into actual fissures against his hegemonic hold on power. I see that in the Ecuador case, it's also effective as eliciting new alliances from non-indigenous intellectuals and students that have allowed for actors to stage successful protests against a president that would, by all measures, has been highly popular and has maintained an unyielding hold on power. And it did so by bringing to light what has been beneath Correa's actions and many of these presidents, and indeed much of larger society's assumptions, a notion of nature as a site of human consumption and appropriation. Yet despite these early successes, the protest movement has encountered significant challenges this year in its attempt to stop Correa from opening up Yasuni to begin oil exploration and extraction. And it is with these challenges in mind that I approach Professor De La Cardena's work. The ontological disagreement evidence in these protest movements certainly produced, I think, an important disruption in politics that was generative. I believe in, at least for the time being, slowing down Correa, and also in light of the popular appeal and favorable reception to protesters, began raising in the broader society and the public opinion some doubts about the character of Correa's project and his citizens' revolution. Yet state power nevertheless was successful in one regard. Despite these actors' attempts to organize a public referendum, which they tried to do in April and March, the state sabotaged their efforts by reinforcing through a public campaign the ontological field that the protesters had initially disrupted. Discourses eerily resembling those of President Alan Garcia's Perro del Hortadero, Orchard Dog, once again reappeared in a public referendum in the government's attempt to manipulate and sabotage their efforts. Indigenous actors and their allies in advocating for earth beings were not just once again called as being infantile indigenous, but as standing in the way of national progress. They were selfish. This was not just, like I said, an infantile indigenism or environmentalism, but one that was put forth in very concrete terms. I'm talking about a public PR campaign that was put in newspapers throughout the country, that they were being irresponsible and absurd for trumping the rights of real life human beings to development and freedom from poverty to those of rocks, trees, dirt, and the oil underneath them. Now, earth being practices and the ontological disagreements they elicit, De La Cardena suggests, can be generative for politics and political protests by provoking, to quote Rancière, a scandal in thinking, by slowing down our reasoning as to what is being threatened by capitalist extractivism and state action. But let me stop and ask further, whose reasoning is it slowing down and how? The who is as other non-indigenous actors, including the broader public. The how is through an understanding of this uncommons that's being opened. Well, what about those others that don't engage, for whom there is no ontological disagreement at all, or for whom, even if the disagreement is to some extent acknowledged, is nevertheless disavowed, buried over by material and political concerns? This, as you know, pops up with regards to environmental concerns particularly. Earth beings get recalled, sent away, when it seems necessary to avoid not just their very destruction, but those of real-life human beings who live in their areas. When the goal of protest action is not just violent dissent or to create an epistemic dissensus, but also material, pragmatic concerns for these populations. Such as stopping mining through the mountain. How then to protest from the uncommons, when the uncommons is not only denied, but its denial might be perceived as necessitated for its own sake and those of the very people that are bringing forth earth beings? The political itself as that field which ontological disagreement seeks to contest is a threat to the other, to young commons in another way that has become evident within these protests, and that's co-optation. Earth beings and practices can also become co-opted by state forces and other non-indigenous actors. That is to say, it might appear that their presence is now being acknowledged, but now it's used and deployed by human actors in strategic ways and for self-defeating ends that can lead to further exploitation and destruction of the uncommons. Now, though not as an earth being practice, what I have in mind is what has happened with the concept of summa causa, which raises this concern for me, because the concept when deployed by the state is being used to legitimate the buen vivir, the good life, as a development framework through which extractivism itself is now being justified as something oriented towards attaining the quote-unquote good life for the rest of the nation. Now, and I'm almost finished, this raises for me a fundamental question also of how such a politics mainly of this aspect of making good on these politics, which is the issue of representation and human agency in relation to the uncommons. This is a critique that has been leveled against my own work and the article that you so kindly cited, and my attempt to also make room for earth beings in politics. I've been asked, how can earth beings and the uncommon become part of politics and acknowledge as part of, quote-unquote, of a reality when the uncommons emerge through human actors, that is, human actors represent, you know, whether it's Mariano, but also yourself and myself, who have done ethnographic work, we're doing that work of representing. So how can the unrepresented be represented and emerge in that way? And as you say, radical difference is not just something indigenous people have, but the radical difference of the uncommons, of mountains, lagoons, other non-human beings that cannot speak on their own or act politically, some would say, but depends upon their articulation by human actors and then the significance it has for them in terms of their own cosmology. And in relation to building a politics for non-indigenous actors predicated upon its insights, how is that possible without translation? And what might be the consequences of that translation? And if not translation, but simply respect, can it be non-essentializing? I agree with you today that in the context of not just Latin America, but in other struggles by indigenous actors all over the world over the state's exploitation of natural resources on ancestral lands, a politics of the uncommons is more needed than ever. The generative quality of such protests has and continues to draw the battle lines of contention at another level, and it is at a level that can generate new modalities of action to revitalize and transform the decolonial movement in countries like Ecuador and others. You're right, can loosen the grasp of state power, ultimately, over what can count as development, politics, and our very common way of life in an even more radical way. Thank you.
Wonderful, wonderful, provocative comments, and Marisol for your lecture, your sharing with us. Now we have, unfortunately, only 5 minutes. Okay, 10 minutes. We got 10 minutes. So I think what we should do is what was done previously: have a series of maybe 3 questions, and then turn it over to Marisol to respond. Yes, in the back.
I'm going to ask the question very quick so that we can have more time. I'm not going to say that much. In the Paracatura Escobar called the modernity, the colonial working group, at some point I made an argument that there was not enough discussion about politics. That there was a need in the so-called decolonial group for a move toward politics, and I find very suggestive your point about the coloniality of politics, but I was left with desire to know more about how you can flesh out that point.
Three questions, then what?
I have a question that has to do with a couple of things. First, translation, and I see that it's everywhere and no one deals with it in a more sophisticated way of what does translation mean, and there's a lot of theories in translation that do that, but there's an idea behind translation, the most obvious one, that when you translate you commodify because you rename, you essentialize, And, you know, we keep on hearing, oh, Tirakuna, Runakuna, as to what point both of you talk about translation and that process of translating, as to what point are you looking at the limits of language vis-a-vis the limits of ontology, and how the translation would therefore imply the political engagement from a decolonial position. And that has to do with also the excess, right? So once you translate, do you eliminate that excess? Or how can you translate without modernizing or allowing the political to exist within the terms of modernity of what a political is?
I don't know if I'm spinning off too much here, but I'm thinking that isn't it also for us that are not only colonizers but being colonized, the same condition that we have to take our response or our resistance from something in us, within our communities, that are not confined within reality or politics? Don't we also have to base our response, our resistance, in our, if I may call it, earth beings? Do you understand what I mean?
Absolutely.
Yeah, okay.
I think we had one more, Arturo, and then we'll have Marisol respond.
Well, I think this would be really interesting for me and for everybody as well. How do we, going back to the colonialism of politics, how do we undo the colonialism of politics in the academy? By sort of reversing your experience with reversing, not starting with the Stengers and Rancière and the big man Latour, but rather starting with, you know, the knowledges and pensamientos of people who don't count in those worlds in which we circulate. So you say that these kinds of worlds and beings don't circulate, don't travel well in the academy. But you attempt to sort of reverse the picture, and that's, I think that's great. It's great for everybody to think about that seriously.
Okay.
Two minutes.
Okay. To begin with, I think that, I don't know, I'm going to start by saying that in order to be able to fruitfully work this framework, we have to both undo and maintain the us-they. Mm-hmm. We have to do both things at the same time. We cannot just continue to maintain it, us-they, but we also have to maintain it because we need to work from the similarity that is the not as they, and at the same time work with a difference that is within that similarity. So when you say we have to decolonize ourselves and not them, that's the vocabulary that not only them, that's the vocabulary that we have to, this is a matter of vocabulary big time, and that's why translation is so important. But it's not only translation, it's not between, it's within our syntax. It's within our syntax that we reinstate the way we think, the who we are, right? So both maintain the distinction and dissolve the distinction and work in that doing both things, which is not what we do. It's either us and them, or we're all the same. We're all moderns, or there's moderns and amoderns. So that's one thing. Coloniality of politics, and going back to the first, the last question too. When Aníbal Quijano talked about started coining the word coloniality, he was talking about coloniality of power. And what I'm trying to do is talk about the coloniality of politics itself. Not of power, but of politics itself. What politics recognizes, what it doesn't recognize, and why does it recognize certain things and doesn't recognize other things. When I say the ontology of politics is historical, I'm not only talking, and that's the other thing, I'm not only talking about earth beings. Earth beings make me think, but it's not only useful to think earth beings. So the coloniality of politics, the ontology of politics is historical. only what is historical can be part of politics. And it's not only Earth beings that are ahistorical. Earth beings are, ahistorical is what is not yet, or what is not seen as being yet. Success, for example. What Michal and Barbara were talking about. So it's, yes, it's the coloniality of politics that needs to be decolonized, but not to decolonize ourselves versus them who are the colonized, but it's decolonizing the coloniality of politics to allow for that which the coloniality of politics doesn't allow, which in my very quick version is an ecology of worlds where divergence is possible and where the uncommons doesn't dissolve when you have a commons. Translation, yes, of course, translation. What translation, my work is thought through translation and shot through and through with translation. It's, all I do is only translation because I've worked there. And it's not only that I, I translate from Quechua to Spanish to English. I translate concepts, and that's why it took me 10 years because I was translating concepts. And but translating concept doesn't mean that I know. Okay, when I use, and that's again why cosmopolitics is so important to me, because of the word cosmos, it's the unknown. So translation doesn't close it to the known. When I translate, I don't finish knowing. I translate into what I can handle, but it doesn't close knowledge. It's not, like Michal said this morning, it's not about what you understand, but what's there that you do not understand. That's what cosmopolitics is about. It's not about knowing. It's about opening it up to what you do not know. That's precisely what that quote that I read, and that's why I didn't finish the paper, because I like that quote, slowing down thought. Okay, I'm going to stop, Sonia.
I'll take a half a minute. So if the next panel could step up to the plate, please. We would ask all of you to, the next panel is about several Latin American cases, and then we end with a spotlight on Brazil. Zil.
I teach here in the sociology department at Barber Center. Do we start, Sonia?
Yes, please.
Yeah. I just came back from Ecuador, and two weeks after I came back, we had the largest demonstrations since 2 years and a half. So, you know, I miss them. And I am tempted to say something here, but I can't because I'm just supposed to be a conduit. This is the panel called Latin American Protests in Global Context. And we're going to start with Rafael Hutner from the Universidad de San Marcos y Programa Democracia y Transformación Global, who's going to be speaking about water and anti-mining protests in Peru. Please give a welcome to Rafael.
Buenas tardes, good afternoon. I do have to say this for me, it's not that easy to speak in English. For two reasons, it's not my first language. And I'm used to speak very fast, and the combination of speaking very fast, not your first language, is not always working out that well. But let's see how it works, yes? Well, I'm still a bit trying to process all of the presentation of Marisol, who I think was brilliant, but also very sophisticated, and I think mine is a bit more trying to talk about the same things, but from a very concrete perspective. The title that I put to it is "This Democracy Ain't Democracy Anymore," which is something very curious because I heard a song from female social leaders from the north and the south of the country who don't know each other with the same title and with a text slightly different, but more or less saying the imposition of mining as a way of living, not as an economic activity, undermines or even destroys democracy. And what I found very interesting as well is to see this kind of languages like the songs as a way of theorizing and thinking about the realities people live. And I think it's one of the most elaborated things I've encountered in these 10 years of working with communities affected by mining. For me, this presentation here is actually the last stop of a quite intense series of activities, of dialogues within social movements, in between social movements and researchers, in Lima, in El Cauca, in Colombia, in Quito, y ahora, and now here. So, yeah, you know, and that's also a bit like you have to put it all together. But I was thinking during all these different conversations over these weeks, a bit of a way of understanding the moment we are living in Latin America. And I found a good metaphor in one of the things that happened in the meeting in El Cauca in Colombia. The meeting started with what they would call a mística, a spiritual moment of trying to connect the cultural diversity in between Afro-descendant people, indigenous, farmers, people like me, but also in relation with the Pachamama, the Mother Earth, and this was in a recuperated farm outside of Popayán in El Cauca, and so there was this whole setup, mystical setup, and around it like 40 candles that were putting lit on and blown out by the wind. So there were 40 candles and a lot of people, social leaders, trying to have all the candles lit on. And they were never, because the wind was quite strong. So I was thinking of how this, in a sense, reflects what's happening in Latin America and how we can look to this in two different ways as well. I think we're definitely not as optimistic as we were like 10 years ago. It's a very different moment in this context of progressive, entre comillas, governments. So we have all these candles blown out who we lit on a while ago, but then we have other candles lit on as well in other countries, in Chile, in Colombia, even in Peru. So, and then this metaphor also of trying to nurture hope, as Boventura says, trying to nurture that these candles are still on in a way, but trying to understand also the wind that's blowing it out. So more or less this metaphor is like the introduction of what I would like to do in the 10 minutes that are left. Trying to understand the changes in the political, economical, cultural scenario we are living, and the ways in which the forms in which we organized over the last 10 years are adapting or not to this, and the new ways of organizing, thinking, and doing that are emerging, responding to these changes in the scenario. So actually, my what I want to do is very political. The paper I wrote, I didn't write it thinking that much of this event. I wrote it more in thinking of discussing these issues with the activists, social leaders, and researchers with whom I'm working in Peru on these issues and with whom we are trying to strengthen our resistances in a very difficult context. So that's a bit the objective of the paper. Now we're going to see if that works out. So I put like 7 hypotheses together, and I'm not going to talk about all 7 of them because that's impossible. So a quick introduction to the Peruvian context. I'm putting all these pictures and photos together as well, with also the intention to show that all the things I'm saying are the result of collective processes of thinking, of discussion, of trying to make sense of reality, and not that much of what I've been thinking. So everything that sounds good is not because of me, and everything that sounds bad is not of me. Yes. So Peruvian society has been transformed dramatically over the last 2.5 decades through 2 articulated logics. One we can call neoliberal capitalism, and the other we can call extractivism, okay? So these reorganized territory social relations trying to mercantilize, not if that's a Spanish word, yes, mercantilize, other territories and other social relations that weren't so before. And well, there's Alan Garcia again, you recognize him from the photo of Marisol before. So this concretely, one picture that shows in what this worked out is how mining concessions have developed over the last 20 years. There were 2 million in 91 and there are 27 million mining concessions now in the country. And that ends up in this map, which is very interesting. The map on the left are the mining concessions. A concession is any kind of territory that could be a mining project if the mine ends up putting together the money, ends up getting a kind of agreement with the local population, etc. It's not that all of these are mines, no, but they could be. And on the other end, we have all the oil concessions. Well, I'm not that sophisticated in putting together the maps, but if we would, obviously more or less all the countries put in concession to some company. This expansion of concessions also generated responses, social responses. These are some of the pictures of different kind of marches, protests around the country, mostly based on these issues of what I would like to call eco-territorial struggles. In Peru, they talk a lot about social environmental struggles, but I really don't think that they do justice to what's really going on. So, getting to the hypothesis, and some I'm only going to mention. The first one is this, that extractivism is a historical civilizatory process which should be understood contemporarily as a biopolitical project. What does that mean? That all dimensions of social life are reorganized, deepening and intertwining capitalism, patriarchy, coloniality, and the exploitation of nature in different geohistorical contexts. So it's not the same in every place, but in all of the places this is getting on this way. And there I wanted to cite Rosa Waman, who's a social leader from Cañaris, a place in the north of the country. And she's talking about territory. No? She says, territory is happiness because it's whom reproduces life. So both, I would say, in the intent to analyze these processes, as well as in the intent to react politically towards this, territory has become a central concept. Well, this is what a mine looks like in Cajamarca. And so extractivist biopolitics implies the material, institutional, and social production of life by different actors throughout society to allow the massive extraction of common goods and its exportation without or with very limited processing. This is a bit taking the definition of Eduardo Mudinas, but also trying to amplify it a little bit more. And well, in the paper, I more or less distinguish like six different logics of this extractivist biopolitics, but now I don't have time to get into it, but you could read it in the paper. The second hypothesis is that in Peru, there's this whole debate if around these issues there is something what we could call social movement. Well, I always found that this debate is very strange, because a social movement is not a thing that I can touch or that I can see walking by, but a bit in that sense the debate is going on, in which most of the analysis state that we do not have social movements because we do not have what we had in the 80s. Well, my position, and from other people like Anthony Babington, Maria Elena Garcia, is that we do have a different kind of social movement, far more fragmented, but with processes of articulation, of accumulation in terms of programs, in terms of impact in society. But this has only been possible because of a series of transformations of how social organizations work in Peru. And I can't go into it too deeply because I want to go a bit more deeply into the next hypothesis. But it's very interesting to see how the local populations that didn't have any more strong national social organizations or political parties from the left, who were very strong in the 80s but disappeared during the civil war or the political conflict, or how we want to call it, found new ways of reconstructing politically their resistances. Crucial strategies there, which I'm just going to mention. The first one is that the regulatory organizations of social life, the market, the Ronda Campesina, who's like the Guardia Indígena, they administrate justice in the communities. La Ronda Campesina, the women organizations who are very dedicated to other kinds of activities in these conflicts, become politicized and actually the crucial basis of resistance. But then again, they need also strategies to articulate them. And as the former strategies didn't work anymore or weren't there anymore, the places of the defense fronts, which are like a kind of articulation in the basis of very concrete conjunctures, became the places to negotiate strategies, a bit in the Melucci sense, but in a very concrete institutional sense. Very active in concrete conjunctures, but not very capable of consolidating organizations discourse. Well, then I'm saying something about the increased role of women, which has been very, very important in the eco-territorial struggles, the new discourses and identities, and also the ways of multiplicating strategies and finding new ways of articulation beyond the local, but from below, not from above. So the march, the National March for Water in Peru was a very interesting example of a march that emerged from Cajamarca and ended up being a national march without any real help of national organizations. I think that's interesting because from these kind of processes, new forms of organization and new forms of articulation that aren't very centralized or very controlled are creating themselves. Well, then, I'm only going to mention it. In Peru, we have this kind of paradox, or not, I'm not sure. It's something we should discuss more, therefore I put it in the paper to discuss it more with the people in Peru. Our successful social struggles have produced weaker organizations and not stronger organizations. So even in the cases that we win, we do not end up with stronger organizations capable of amplifying its social base, creating alternatives. Well, obviously there's some differences in between the cases, but in general, a lot of the organizations that protagonize the strongest social struggles some years after are weaker than ever before. And then I have some reasons for that, but those are also in the paper. Then, the fourth hypothesis, and this one I do want to touch a bit more because it has to do also with the themes of this meeting. So I'm saying that instead of the criminalization of protest, we can recognize an articulated complex of mechanisms and practices that criminalize dissidents. So I feel that this discourse of criminalization of protest is really not helping us understanding what's really getting criminalized. Okay? So here you can see a list of several of these mechanisms, some of direct violence and others of adapting the legal framework, of supervising civil society and development cooperation, the militarization of social conflicts. In Peru, there are the police in their spare time, they work as security of the mining companies. Well, anything. Muchas cosas, ¿no es cierto? In the Peruvian case, these articulated practices have led to more than 200 deaths over the last 10 years within democracy. So I think that's very very important to note. Marilyn Serna, who's a very important Colombian social leader, said it in the best way for me. She said, "We are criminalized for being coherent with whom we are." I think this is it's a very intelligent way of putting it. So what I want to say about this for the discussion in the coming days are three things. No? The first one is a very big worry about what's going to happen in Latin America over the coming years, or what's already happening. I think the intensification of authoritarianism, criminalization, violence of different types is really one of the main worries we should have of people being engaged with social movements. I think we're really entering in a phase that's very, very worrying in almost all the countries of the region. So that's the first one, and the most important one for me. The second one is this question of how should we understand this state that, in the words of Boaventura, no, that systematically violates its own legality, being within democracy entre comillas. No, I think that's a question we should think about. And the third issue is what's being criminalized. I think in the Peruvian case, this idea of criminalization of dissidents understood of the ways in which we think, live, feel, do, organize in different ways than the ways extractive patriarchal colonial capitalism imposes on us, has some very concrete ways which are being criminalized. The first one is the production of ways of collective decision making without the state. So processes of communalization, defending of the community or creating new kind of communities, because those both things are going on. And the other one has to do quite clearly for me with the new relations and discourses about the relations in between humanity and nature. Also defending relations in the sense that Marisol has been talking about, but also the new ways of understanding and relating us with nature that emerge through all these kind of processes. And I think that's something very important to note as well, is that the discourse and the feeling of Pachamama for people who are not indigenous within the cities, who are descendants of indigenous within the cities, are ways of reconstructing something new, which is clearly spiritual. It's not the same as what we had before, but it is way of this kind of search for new ways of relations in between humanity and nature and Pachamama. So I think these are two concrete ways of dissidents that are being criminalized very directly, and which are part of what's happening in Ecuador, in Peru, and even in Bolivia, in a different way. So then we're going to go to the fifth hypothesis. How long was
it?
5 minutes. Oh, right. Yeah. Not bad. Not bad. For Agustina, I do have 5, so I'm going to take 5. So the fifth hypothesis is, and here is also the. Yeah, I didn't. And also the fifth hypothesis also tries to dialogue with other movements, other issues, and other countries. Because I'm not sure about it, so it's a question as well. I'm saying that the fragmentation and multiplication of conflict in extractivist territories reflect the increasing complexity of extractivism. What we were talking about in lunch, is that before it was quite easy. You had the population that was critical about mining or was against mining. And they were in conflict with the mine and the national government. And sometimes they were accompanied by the local government. So it was like one echte conflict. See? Nowadays, at least in Peru, we have like 7-8 different kind of conflicts which are intertwined, mixed, overlapping, and a lot of them are also conflicts in between the people. So I put on a list of several ways in which this idea of the extractivism and the resistance against extractivism and the conflicts around it have fragmented and have been more complex, are increasingly complex. So one has to do with the expansion of mining in the context of ecological crisis. In the whole region, the pretensions of expansion of mining are enormous. Second one, very important, is the geopolitical dimension. The entrance of specifically China, but also India and Brazil within the conflicts really changes the logics of conflicts and also changes the kind of ways in which politics operates. Third one has to do with the extractivist and neoliberal counter-reform by nationalist government in the Peruvian case, or the progressive governments in Ecuador and Bolivia. In the case of extractivism, it's fairly clear that we have a really counter-reform that creates legal frameworks that are far more favorable to these extractive activities than before. Then we have the informal mining in Peru and the cooperativist mining in Bolivia, which is the mining done by the people themselves in different ways, not the big companies, other kind of conflict. We want to do the mining, not the company. In Bolivia, we already have death due to these kind of conflicts. Then we have the pro-extractivist mobilizations. As the conflicts have become stronger and have paralyzed some mining projects, in the Peruvian case in between 10 and 15, including the biggest one, we have more populations who are mobilizing in favor of extractivism. Still not that strong, but I foresee that it will be stronger. And then one that I want to mention specifically, I think Mexico is the case where we can see this clearest, and Colombia historically. These kind of territorial disputes in between different kind of economies, illegal economies, gray economies, white economies, and social movements, and that are getting also increasingly a more violent character. First, he went very quickly from 5 to 1 minute. So then, the alternatives, because all of this might sound quite pessimistic, and it's true that we are in a very difficult context. What I wanted to say is that I see in the sixth hypothesis, I'm trying to interact with two concepts that can allow strategic political thinking in this context. So one has to do with transiciones, which is the idea of transitions that Eduardo Budinas has worked out a lot, which is very interesting because it allows to engage in political debate within the political arena. But then again, I think it fails a clear idea of who are the political subjects of this, what kind of power relations do we need for this, and the idea of the grietas, the cracks of John Holloway. No? And I'm not that much engaging with the whole theoretical basis of this, because I know that there's a whole debate and things we can say in favor and against. But the ideas of political strategies around these two ideas, the transitions as a kind of political politics of short term, but also a generatory politics of more radical reform in Adelante, and the grietas as the places of prefigurative politics of resistance, of defense, of territory in concrete places. And I'm gonna try to wrap it up. So one of the things we should talk about is how do these two dimensions interact? How do they relate? Because I think that in a lot of the political transformations that even in the Peruvian case we have accomplished, and there's the whole list, I think there's a mixture of both. But I can't say much about it. So what I want to stop with is also for the political discussion and for the discussion for tomorrow is that, in a sense, I feel that in the transformations of the historic social organizations, there are strong limitations of finding new ways of doing politics, of finding new identities, new discourses to reinvent themselves in this scenario. So I'm not sure if these will be the vehicles of political transformation in the new period. And the clearest example of this is that all national social organizations, including the strongest ones like the MST and the CONAIE in Ecuador, are going through periods of deep crisis, or in todo caso, the necessity of rethink themselves. On the same end, I think that both from the local, rural levels, but also in the cities, there are emerging new kind of languages, practices, horizons of change, and new or renovated struggles. And I think in them we can like recognize maybe three narratives that are getting like intertwined, if that's a word, and that have a
three narratives is going to take you into another three.
I'm just going to mention them. or do you want me to stop without mentioning them? Entonces, some three ideas I think that we have to think about a bit more. The first one has to do with the relations with nature. I talked about it already. The second narrative is the one of self-determination, individual and collective. And I think there's a kind of dialogue possible that we have to explore more. And the third one is spirituality. The search for sense in a world that's losing sense quicker and quicker. So I think that these are like spaces we have to explore more. And therefore, and that's the last thing I'm going to say, we have to ask ourselves what kind of knowledges, research, practices, languages, and relations with transformatory subjects we do need. And I put a picture of myself with a group of people with whom we do research in a participatory way.
And you can barely tell who you are there.
And using other kind of ways of constructing knowledge, as in this case, the participatory wall painting. And which is really a way of getting more into the kind of subjective changes going on. Well, thank you very much.
Now we're going to have, good morning. George Sicaredo from Drexel University is going to speak a riot, revolution, recuperation, mapping protest cycles in Venezuela.
Sorry, you can just keep looking at his pictures because I don't have pictures for you, sadly. Thank you. In early 2014, a wave of anti-government protests broke out in Venezuela, first in the opposition stronghold of Táchira near the Colombian border, but quickly expanding to a number of major cities and garnering widespread international attention for the movements and condemnation for the government response. Communicating largely through Twitter and draped conspicuously in the flag of global revolt, these seemingly spontaneous protests and street barricades might seem to be the obligatory starting point of departure for any discussion of Venezuelan and Latin American Táchira moments. But today I want to dispute both the temporality of this claim and its political implications, instead insisting that if there's anything like a Táchira moment for Venezuela, it was the massive 1989 anti-neoliberal riot known as the Caracazo. But what strange chronology is reflected in the suggestion that Venezuela's Caracazo constituted a Táchira moment some two decades before the fact? Semantics aside, one could argue that Táchira was instead that symbolic moment when the smoldering global anti-neoliberal backlash landed in Cairo. But this requires both casting aside the standard interpretations of the Arab and North African Spring, that it was all about citizen participation against entrenched authoritarianism, and drawing instead upon underlying socioeconomic conditions and structures. And it also means pressing for a sharper conceptualization of what the Caracazo was in Venezuela and what Táchira was. And what follows, I want to argue that the Caracazo is not best understood as a localized revolt, but instead as an upheaval that in many ways inaugurated a cycle of global protest, whose broad parameters are negatively a rejection of neoliberalism in a lot of ways, and positively the pioneering of new forms of direct and democratic participation. I argue that it's by displacing the recent wave of protest in Venezuela to instead focus on this point of inflection 25 years ago that we can grasp the essential contours of the broad cycle of participatory protest that we're currently witnessing, but also to draw toward an improved understanding of one of the indecipherable sphinxes of our times, the riot. Few modalities of protest are subject to such contradictory tensions, both patently essential for the revolutionary upheavals that have shaped our history, and also insistently sidelined as apolitical, pre-political, and irrational by the very heirs of an enlightenment that would not exist if it were not for the action of the mob. And I turn here, in many ways, echoing what Barbara said about Badiou, to speak about Alain Badiou, and specifically his work in The Rebirth of History on riots. And I see Badiou as doing something very, very good, and then making some, I think, key mistakes. What he does so well is to provide what I understand as a key bridge in the terms of this discussion between Tahrir and the Caracazo by formulating Tahrir as a riot, by bringing Tahrir into the category of riot. But then I argue that he mistakenly constrains and contains riots within that very same formulation. So what Badiou does roughly is to put forward a threefold typology of different riots, beginning with what we would mostly understand as riots, in other words, what he calls an immediate riot. And then building through an intermediate category toward what he then calls the sort of advanced category is the historical riot. And when you look at the characteristics of the historical riot, as Alain Badiou defines them, they are derived almost directly and in an unalloyed way from the experience of Tahrir. In other words, the three defining characteristics of a historical riot for Badiou, quote, "A riot becomes historical when its localization ceases to be limited, but grounds in the occupied space the promise of a new long-term temporality. Secondly, when its composition stops being uniform, but gradually outlines a unified representation in mosaic form of all the people. And thirdly, when finally the negative growling of pure rebellion is succeeded by the assertion of a shared demand whose satisfaction confers an initial meaning on the word victory." In other words, one, space, the occupation of space in time; two, the unification of a conception of the people; and three, the unification of what constitutes a shared victory. Tahrir is thus not a moment at all for Badiou, but the reaching out of fidelity to that moment toward the horizon of the idea with a capital I. Its institutionalization in time and in space, and if not political organization, then at least its possibility. If the virtue of Badiou is to bring Tahrir into the category of the riot and to vindicate the opening in history that riots often represent, this virtue itself becomes a vice. Firstly, what I argue in the paper is that he makes the kind of the historical error of claiming that Tahrir constitutes the opening of a new historical sequence. And in many ways, the paradigmatic example of what that sequence represents. I think this overlooks what has been building and developing over the course of a number of decades. Secondly, and more seriously though, I think that by deriving the historical riot so directly from the experience of Tahrir, he reproduces in a lot of ways this traditional rejection of the riot, rejection of the mob, rejection of this irrationality of these forms of political action. Because what he's insisting on is the extending of the riot forward into the future, but also in many ways specifying certain forms that should take. And I think this becomes very clear when we then try to take this understanding of the riot to look at 1989 in Venezuela, the massive riot that actually made possible everything that had happened in Venezuela since. And if we think in terms of the threefold understanding of what constitutes a historical riot for Badiou, the first one being space, the Caracazo didn't really occupy space. It was a really unmediated and what he would call an immediate riot, even though it lasted nearly a week, which is kind of incredible for an immediate riot. But the conception of continuity in time really needs to be stretched, I argue, across much longer historical chains for Badiou's formulation to fit. Its extension in time for more than a week is incredible given its character as a pure riot. And within the fertile space of the streets, filaments began to stretch, reach out, connect, and draw together. Understood in terms of the still longer temporality of months and years, these connections did in fact generate a popular institutionalization in the space in the form of Badiou assemblies, which eventually generated what has come to be known as communal councils. But this doesn't fit in the very narrow understanding of the first element of Badiou's analysis. The second one, the claim in the putting forth of a conception of a unified people, you could argue that it fits a little better, but it's a much longer historical vision. It's understood best in a kind of counter-hegemonic way because it's really one conception of the people being posed as a fragment almost in a Rancièrean way, but also through people like Enrique Dussel, you can see it against this other conception, traditional conception of the people. The third, in terms of this unifying demand through which victory is conceived, Again, this really needs to be stretched if we're trying to understand the relationship between 1989 and what has happened since. It has to be stretched over months and years, because we find direct and sort of spontaneous, unmediated opposition to a neoliberal reform package first. But in the streets, you find this demand itself becoming unified, constituting itself as a demand, but then also radicalizing into more significant demands. You know, the fall of the government, the eventual destruction of the two-party system, and ultimately the unspecified demand for a new form of both participatory democracy and socialism. To turn toward the present, toward the 2014 protest, I engage with the use of the idea of repertoires of protest by Alejandro Velasco, who some of you may know. But he's got a book coming out about urban popular movements in Venezuela that's very good, called Barrio Rising. It will be coming out, I think, this year. But he uses the idea of combative repertoires of protest, and he did use it, you know, in presentations around the time of these protests in 2014 to explain what was going on, and to explain two things in particular. Firstly, their continuity, the idea that suddenly, in February of 2014, it wasn't that suddenly people were protesting in Venezuela. Velasco argues that people constantly and protest every day, every week, all across Venezuela. Just simply that these protests appeared differently for very specific reasons, class reasons, the use of Twitter, the distinction marked with regard to the everyday protests by generally poor people and especially barrios, the street blockades to make certain demands. But the more important distinction he draws is that this continuity of combative street protests in Venezuela usually has a specific orientation toward power. And Velasco argues that, he calls it a protest ante el gobierno instead of anti el gobierno. Protest before the government to make certain demands, as opposed to what you call more insurrectionary movements against the government. Now, I think this is a very powerful framework. He knows that I disagree with him about it, because I think it's very unified throughout time, whereas I think you have moments in Venezuela around in 1989 and 92 where more people, in a relative sense, are willing to take action against the government. But I do think what you did see very clearly in the protests in early 2014 in Venezuela was the fact that many people who did not even support the government of Maduro did not take to the streets to protest it, because they saw it as an insurrectionary anti-governmental movement when they said, well, we didn't win this election, but it was an election and it was legitimate. And so I want to push back a little bit on the kind of the unified specific political orientation that Velasco grants to this idea. And then I want to add to it the idea of the sort of parallel trajectory alongside this continuity of repertoires of protest in Venezuela, which is the tendency, and this overlaps with things that people have said already, the tendency toward the historical co-optation of protest repertoires. And this is a global phenomenon. These protests in Venezuela in 2014, part of their self-presentation was precisely to say, this is a spontaneous movement. And yet, when we begin to dissect them and understand where they come from, you start to realize it's not so spontaneous, and there's a reason they have to present themselves as spontaneous. It's rather the third act in a series of acts, the first of which, I argue, is the U.S. government funding of and foundation of opposition parties in Venezuela, especially around 2000-2001, giving rise to the party Primero Justicia through funding for the National Endowment for Democracy, the International Republican Institute. This party, Primero Justicia, splits in more recent years, and so that both of the major opposition leaders in Venezuela come out of this single party, which was essentially a creation of the U.S. State Department. The second act, very interestingly, was another series of spontaneous student protests in 2007 around the withdrawal of the concession to RCTV, an opposition TV station. At that time, very similarly, you had the emergence of protests. You had the insistence that they were apolitical, unconnected to political parties, although we all kind of knew at the time that they were, and there were very clear signs of this. You had recorded phone calls with opposition leaders saying, well, we can't make it look like we're controlling these protests because that will discredit them. And then after those protests, 2007, you had all of these student leaders joining opposition political parties. This is the third sort of stage of that act, but what's going on the whole time, and this is really the key, is that you have a global network of nonviolence protest training. And this is connecting Serbia, this is connecting some of the groups, you know, that are operating different countries. Institutions like the Albert Einstein Institution, which is founded by Gene Sharp, a theorist of nonviolence, that go around and train people, regardless of political orientation, to use nonviolence, nonviolent methods of civil disobedience in an effort to destabilize governments. And so you had these institutions training these opposition groups in Venezuela and co-opting, I would argue, the repertoires of protest, not only nonviolence, but also the traditional repertoires in Venezuela, the street blockade, the burning blockade, the hijacking of vehicles, things that were traditional in the Venezuelan context, and turning them toward much more conservative ends. To turn away from then these protests in early 2014 and turn our sort of, you know, in a gesture of fidelity to Tahrir, I argue we need to turn our attention back to this longer cycle. And to ask the question, which is kind of a paradoxical question, which is also the paradoxical question of Venezuela today, which is what happens to Tahrir in government? Can there be such a thing as a riot state, a political administration that is truly faithful to the event in Baduyan terms? To even begin to address the question requires that we stretch Baduyan's analysis, because the effect of that analysis, as I've shown, is to instead sever the chains necessary for grasping that history. We need instead to tie the riot and the political event, more broadly speaking, to identity and collective memory in a way that is more lasting and sustainable, even beyond the extent and temporality of the historical riot. Once we do so in the context of contemporary Venezuela, we both realize very quickly that there's nothing historic in the Baduyan sense about the recent wave of protests, and that the only history they contain is a history to be dug up and revealed of the strategic recuperation of protest by the Latin American far right, and the increasingly clear links every day of connections between these movement leaders and Uribe in Colombia are no accident. We turn instead to both the development and consolidation of Chavista political identity on the one hand, and the institutionalization of that identity in the current process of communization on the other. According to the former commune minister and recently named culture minister, Reynaldo Durriza, those comprising the Chavista subject of subjects share not only a class origin, but as he puts it, a common experience of politicization, a baptism by fire that incorporated the act of rebellion into the political. In other words, the rebellion in 1989, the attempted coup in 1992, into a long chain of events. The emergence of Chavismo here, echoing Badiou, constitutes a political event that creates the possibility for changes. It's this political identity, among others, popular identity, gendered identity, racial, ethnic, class identity, that explains the longevity of the process of change in Venezuela, but one which was punctuated by other moments, events of rebellion and resistance, especially the 2002 coup, the oil lockout later that year, all of which have steeled revolutionary identity. If Chavismo as a political identity has been peculiar for its ability to, as Iturriza puts it, to incorporate the act of rebellion into the political, the form of that incorporation differs over times and has leapt forward in the space between movements and the state. The Barrio Assemblies of the 90s generated the institutionalization of communal councils in 2006, and popular efforts to consolidate communal power from below have seen the formal consolidation of councils into ever larger unions, first communes and then communal cities. That bring together self-managed councils and in both the political and the economic terrains. This tense unity of opposites that Iturriza poses as rebellion versus slash within the political was described by one inspiring militant intellectual, the late guerrilla comandante Kleber Ramirez Rojas, as a similarly tense government of popular insurgency. But if anchoring political transformation to the riot through such extended dialectical chains evades the explanatory dead end of Badiou's typology, it also confronts inevitable dangers at the boundary of collective memory. Even the most painful or glorious memories fade, and with them the stability of those invisible fibers that bind political identity in time. With the loosening or collapse of those ties of collective memory, there emerges the risk that the radical repertoires, cynically masking themselves, sometimes quite literally so, in the tactical trappings of the poor, will again step in and attempt to seize the reins. Thank you.
Thanks, George, also for keeping the time. It is tricky. I hope to pronounce your name the right way. Now we are going to hear from Tata Gatan, Ravindran from the University of Texas at Austin, from populist to institutionalist politics, cultures of protest in contemporary Bolivia. Please welcome.
Mm-hmm. First of all, thank you everyone, and thank you for pronouncing my name right. A few people who can do that, and I would also like to thank Charlie for informing me about this conference, and Sonia for inviting me, and the edited volume which you and Dr. Escobar did was one of the first books I read on Latin America from the other part of the world. And now both of them are in front of me, and that's great. So, and I'm more excited to be speaking on Bolivia, because any conference on protests should include Bolivia, because Bolivia is one place where acts of protest have been the protagonists of social and political transformation. I remember reading an article long back which said, in Bolivia, social movements are the most powerful on earth. So I'll read the paper. Massive mobilizations against neoliberalism and the deepening of structural racial and class